Hello, welcome everybody. It's wonderful to see everyone here today. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Jocelyn Williamson, and on behalf of the Central Florida Freethought community, I'd like to welcome you to today's event. As Lauren said, you know, the fact that we got out of bed and we made it here by 1 o'clock is already a step in the right direction. Most people don't do that on a Sunday. Please take a moment, put your phones on mute if you are having them. You're welcome to take pictures if you want, but please make sure the sound's off. In the past couple of years, I've attended some free thought events and different types of events where I've had to talk about who am I, what is my belief system, what's a free thinker, what's an atheist, what's morality, and I realized that I had to develop a kind of clear response to this. And in the end, I decided, okay, I'm a secular humanist. And then I say that to people, and people say to me, well, what's a secular humanist? So I realized I needed a little bit more than a title. You know, I am a strong believer that you need to be open about being a non-believer. And I realize that for some people at their work, with their families, it may cause big rifts. I don't necessarily advocate for that. But I do think it's important that we step up and say, hey, we're here, I'm volunteering in the soup kitchen, and that's where I'm coming from. I'm a humanist. Humanism isn't a religion, right? There's no set of books, there's no instructions, there's no requirements to be here on Sunday, though it's really nice. Humanism is that not so radical idea that you can be good without a belief in a God. And I believe that we can get closer to understanding our world through observation, experimentation, rational analysis. And as a humanist, I believe that what is right and the measure of the rightness or wrongness of an action or a choice has something to do with human well-being and fulfillment. So the test of the rightness isn't the extent to which you're living up to that cosmic plan that somebody's told you need to be following. It's the morality of the action should be according to its effect on people in the here and now, and the people that we're going to be leaving behind, like my son, things like that. And I believe that we can and we should create our own meaning and purpose in life. Humanism stands for the building of a more humane society through ethics based on human, other natural values, spirit of reason, and free inquiry. And this is what I was thinking about how to open up today, and I decided I was going to talk about humanism a little bit. These are the words that popped into my head. You can have your own. I also think the word community is a big part of that, and that's part of the reason why I thought having the word community was really important in the Central Florida free thought community. I didn't like the idea of a society. You know, we David and I brainstormed names for a long time. I think community is really important. And over the past 3 years, the organization has grown significantly. We're really proud of the work that we've done as a community. And just looking at this second educational event that we're having here, speaker series, people are still coming. It's great and it's exciting. And we hope that you're going to enjoy these talks that we're making available. I would now like to introduce David to talk briefly about other parts of what the CFFC does. David?
We have a lot of great volunteers, but I think I need to add clappers to the volunteer list. You know, if you want people to clap, all you need is a couple of people to do it. However, I was on a panel on Friday, and somebody said something I thought was extremely important and deserved a round of applause, and I clapped by myself for at least 5 or 7 seconds. And I was in the front of the room at the head table, and I dragged it out until people clapped, though. I peer pressured and coerced them into it. We know how that works. So, it's a good virus. There's got to be a good one out there, right? The one that makes you lose just the right amount of weight. As opposed to 10 or 15 pounds over a week. So welcome everyone, really glad that you're back. Some of you are here for the first time, and that's fantastic. Some of you that are back and know everybody in the room, that's great. Even if you've been here before, I'm sure there's someone here you haven't met. So do them a favor, do us a favor as a community, and make them feel welcome. Make them want to come back, okay? Because we're not all here to hear how smart and awesome Andrew is. Some of us are here because we want to make friends, meet new people, and I know Andrew wants to meet all of you too, so make sure you do that. So take the time to meet the folks that are in the room here. As many of you know, one of the organization's main purposes is to protect our rights as a religious minority through state church activism. You've read about our litigation, you've heard about the letters that we've written, and those written on our behalf by the Freedom From Religion Foundation. Those have been very effective. You know about our work in the schools and the local government, much because of the help of the local media. We actually have much more going on than that, and we're not going to stand up here and list all the things out for you. We're going to introduce those to you a little bit at a time. Some of those things you are involved in as a community member, some of those things you've benefited from and may not know it. There's a lot of things that are going on. If you want to know more, ask questions, but look for those things to be given to you a little bit at a time, because we don't want to just dump a list on you. We want you to appreciate those things. Today, let's talk about one of those things, but to do that, we have to talk about American exceptionalism. Yay, America! We're awesome because we have pretty GIF files that will wave and show you the American flag. So we have this precious democracy, which means everything's hunky-dory in the U.S. of A., right? We're awesome, we have a democracy, and we're good to go. We go to the polls every year, we elect the people, just like you and me, to go and represent you and me in Tallahassee and in Washington. We're the people that they work for, and they know it, right? So there's nothing to worry about. It's a democracy. You're laughing, but I know that you're getting my point, right? The idea is that this thing takes maintenance. It's not as easy as setting up a system and letting it work. That's not the case in almost anything that I could think of when I was considering what analogy to give this, whether it's a car, whether it's a club, whether it's anything. You have to maintain it, okay? Or it's just going to get worn into the ground and thrown into the landfill with everything else. This system is being maintained, just not by us. Okay? Some of us in this room are involved in that maintenance, and some of us have no idea what the hell I'm talking about. And I'm going to introduce that to you. So there are people on the other side, those who would like to impose their beliefs, their ideas, on your life and on our system of government. They are doing system maintenance. Okay? You voted. Did your candidate win? I'm betting the candidate that you voted for didn't win. I've seen the makeup of the legislature. So if your candidate did win, that's great. So how do they know what you think? Are you telling them? Are you letting your candidate know what you think of the issues that are coming up before the legislature in Tallahassee? I'm sure it's easy to get the voice of local, but it's going to be pretty damn hard to get the president's attention on an issue, right? Then you've got the Congress. Then you've got the state. You've got Rick Scott, the governor. He's not listening to you. He's listening, supposedly, to every Floridian. But you have someone in your area who should be listening to you better. You have someone in your city, in your county, that should be listening to you better. As you get to the local level, you have a lot more influence than you realize. And I suspect you know who the president is, who the governor is, and maybe the mayor. Okay, that's just my guess. I know some of you are on the ball more than that. I had to pick up and figure out who was my representative a few years ago when I started walking around giving people a hard time about not knowing, and I'm saying, shit, I don't know. I've got to figure out. Before I can say to people, you've got to be able to do something, I've got to know who I'm represented by. And I had the pleasure, so to speak, of shaking the hands of Senator David Morris and Jason Broder, my representative recently. Neither of them give a shit about what I think as a secular humanist. Okay, I know this because of how they vote. They're certainly not voting the opposite I would every way. We have a lot of things in common with everyone in this room and everyone in the world, and we share a lot of values. So not every representative or senator that you don't vote for or like is voting against you on every bill, but a lot of times they are. Are you guys getting any feedback? Is it sounding okay?
Yes.
Okay, right. It's just up here.
All right.
So, and of course some of your candidates lost. Are you just waiting until next time for someone to rescue the system, and then maybe if you have a candidate that you want there, they'll do what you want? How many bills do you think are on tap for the Florida legislature so far this year? Anybody got a guess?
25.
Yeah.
200.
Okay, that's a good guess. No other guesses? Okay. The Senate has 282 bills. The House has 500. It's 5 months away, and there are 500 issues that the people that represent you are going to deal with. So the question is, do they know what you think about those 500 issues? Probably not.
Who's here to find out what the issues are?
They may not even know you exist, okay? So here's some examples of bills we're watching. We have a recent volunteer. I was doing this the last couple of years just on my own, trying to keep up with what's going on. It is a lot of work. There are bills and bills and bills. As you said, 500 issues plus 200 in the other house or in the other chamber in Tallahassee, right? We're not talking about the U.S. government. This is just Tallahassee. So these are some of the things we're watching. The good bills on the top, prohibited discrimination against the LGBT community. I'm not going to go into the details. You can find that. Conversion therapy outlawed for minors. It's legal right now to pray the gay away for your kids, if that's what you want to do, in an official capacity with an actual therapist. Conversion therapy is legal for minors. And it's outlawed in some states, and this will be the third year that they've tried to outlaw it, and it hasn't made it yet. So they're darn sure not voting for your interest if that has taken 3 years to not pass. Women's reproduction, there are at least a half a dozen bills last year that I remember, and probably many more because I wasn't focused on it like a laser. The Pastor Protection Act. We need to make sure that the pastors don't have to marry the gays, right? That's the idea here. So I don't want to joke about this because the jokes have all been told and they're all hilarious. But the fact is that this is an unnecessary bill, just like the Sharia law bills and all those things that really don't do anything for anyone other than pander to those religious right voters that seem to have the very short-term focus and are focused on fear. We'll talk about that in a minute. And then the rest. So concealed carry. I don't know what your opinion of this is, but you should know that concealed carry is coming to the legislature this year for a vote. Okay? So this is going to be important to many of you, and we're not going to agree on this, but it's something that you need to know about, and your representative and senator need to know what you think. So there's a lot more bills yet to be filed. 5 months before the session starts. Bills are filed all the way up into the session. So this system can work, but it won't work the way we want it to unless we do three things effectively. First, we have to vote. And if we want to ensure our candidates get elected, we have to put the time and effort into getting them elected. If you really want your candidate elected, you've got to donate, you've got to volunteer, you've got to talk to friends and family, and you've got to change their mind. I don't like selling things to people, and I certainly don't want to go and talk to people, and I never would in an official capacity about my candidate, my favorite. But you know, you've got to go and tell people what you think. You've got to impose your beliefs onto other people, and that is hard to do. We're all free thinkers, and we all want to think for ourselves, but you've got to say, you know, you may like this candidate, but he or she voted this way last year. Okay? Know the people that you're for and against so that you can have those talking conversations. And we're going to try to arm you with that as we move forward. It's not going to be, you know, a 10-minute download of the legislature every month in this meeting, because that will bore the crap out of some of you, but we'll make sure that you have those resources. Next, once they're there, we need to be sure that they know exactly what we want from them, what matters to us, and how we expect them to vote on important issues. We need you to vote yes on this bill, and here's why. We need you to vote no on this bill, and here's why. And you've got to do it in a way that doesn't make you look crazy, because the crazy emails are the ones that make you as a secular humanist or whatever label you have look bad. So you want to make sure you represent yourself and your peers in a good way when you contact these folks, whether it's through action alerts or your own initiative. So this doesn't mean that they'll listen to us, but you can be damn sure that they're not going to know what you think unless you tell them. Okay? Like I said, the other side's doing all the maintenance. We've got to start doing it ourselves. Third, and perhaps most important, is to ensure that we join with others and support organizations which make it their mission to advocate for the things that we care about. Like Tony told us last month in the ISHV, these organizations have the voice of thousands or tens of thousands of people that think the way you think on some specific issues. They're not going to think the way you think on every issue. You may not find an atheist organization that's going to go to the Capitol and advocate for you, but you can certainly find a women's organization. You can find an LGBT organization and work with religious people in those organizations and get the changes made that you want to make. Because we're not advocating for atheism in government. We're advocating for secular values which benefit everyone, and especially religious minorities. So everybody wants to work together on these that are on your side. You have thousands of people that agree with you. They just might go to church, and that's okay. These are 501c3, 501c4 organizations who make it their mission to affect change in the legislature. There are limitations, lobbying rules, and all that. We're not going to deal with that now. We'll be hearing from one of these organizations next month. Kelly Damereaux, who's the interim executive director of the Secular Coalition for America, is a friend of ours. She lives in Brevard, and she's going to be traveling down for the Thanksgiving holiday. The 22nd, I believe, is the Sunday before Thanksgiving. That's when we're going to be right back here talking with Kelly, and she's going to tell us about the Secular Coalition for America. They lobby on behalf of atheists, humanists, and secularists, not for atheism in government, but to make sure that the religious right doesn't make exceptions, doesn't dictate how we live our lives based on their rules. If you're going to communicate with those who represent you in Tallahassee or in Washington, you need to know who they are. Even more importantly, you should know your local city council, city commission, county council members are. You can have a much more of an impact and more frequently on issues directly affecting you and your family at the local level. So these are all the people that are deciding what happens in our government, in your life. Now, I am not surprised, and I'm not even disappointed that you don't know who all these people are. I'm not going to ask for one person to say, yeah, I know who they all are. That's great. I'm sure some people know who most of them are. Some of you may know who all of them are. But the fact is that if you don't know who all of them are, you're not being represented. There's a link on the handout that you're going to get when you leave today. Bob and Terrence are going to try to hand you a piece of paper. If you'll let them, that'd be great. It's got our survey link and some other stuff. It's got the link to the Florida House page. There are other pages where you can find this information, but this one has the most information. I don't see one that goes from the local all the way up to the national level. And in fact, I don't see very many local resources because they're so widely varied, as you can imagine, with all the jurisdictions. But let's go to the Florida House page, and I'm skipping right into the website. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
I'm skipping right into the website where you can see this page. It's under the representatives page, and then there's a button called Find Your Representative. And this is the House page, not the Senate page. The Senate page doesn't provide as much information as the House page. They are managed two different departments. So we live today at the University Club. So we're 841 North Park Avenue. Winter Park. And there you go. NSA knows where you live. They probably already knew. So this gives you the information. Unfortunately, there's not active links to each of these people, but they're easy to find. Okay? This is who our state house representative is. Senator Andy Gardner. Pretty powerful guy in Tallahassee. That'd be good to know. John Micah. He's been around since the 1900s. Oh, this one has two. Bill Nelson. So this is everybody in the House and Senate at the state and the national level. It's all right there on one page. All you had to do was plug in your address. Pro tip, right click, select that, right click, and you can actually search. If you're in a reasonable browser, you can actually find information right there with a right click. So that's that. That's simple enough. Now, we've done some of this homework in class, kids. So next month, we're going to impress the shit out of Kelly by knowing who our representatives and who our senators are. Okay? Those of you that choose to play, obviously. We're free thinkers, so you're free to ignore me. Give me one second to re-navigate here. Okay. As I said, the local elected leaders are much easier to find. Just call City Hall, City Council, the City Commission, the County Commission's offices. The number's right there on the website. Cities and some counties like Orange may have elected mayors, but they're pretty much commissioners or council members that are geographically distributed. One last thing, voters' guides. We've not used these in Florida, as far as I know, from the secular perspective. It's an important project. Have you seen voters' guides? Anybody ever used a voters' guide? I use voters' guides every year. I use the church's voters' guides. And let me show you why. Here's one. FL Family. What could be wrong with that? Florida Family Policy Council. Anti-women, anti-choice. Let's pop that link open. Okay, so I'm not going to try to navigate and zoom in on here, but the Florida Family Policy Council is concerned with the exact opposite of almost everything we're concerned with. So we can use their voter's guide to make good decisions. But I want a voter's guide that has our label on it next year. And we're going to do that. And I hope it's not just me doing a voter's guide. I hope you're helping me. Okay, but it's going to happen, so trust me, I will help make sure it happens, but I'd love to put a committee of folks together that want to do that. It's not that hard. The hardest part is probably making it look sexy, right? The easiest part is putting the questions together and emailing them or sending them to those folks to get them answered. And we don't have to do the entire state. We don't have to do the national level. A lot of these folks aren't even going to respond, but that's an answer right there. If they don't respond, that's an answer. And we can source information on their voting choices just like was done here by the Florida Family Policy Council. They pulled this information from sources. Not every answer probably came from a direct question that was answered or ignored, because I'm surely hopeful that some of these candidates ignored some of the questions the Florida Family Policy Council asked as well. So we're going to do a voter's guide next year, 2016, for the Florida. And I think if we can expand that, then that'd be great, but it's just going to depend on the resources that we have. So hopefully you're interested in that. Okay, the fact is that we can make a difference. I'm one who believes that we are progressing, we are moving forward, we are becoming more secular as a society and as a government. I know not everybody believes in that.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay, some people that I talk to in the movement are very much, kind of given up on the idea. The fact is more non-believers are running for office, more powerful organizations are being formed with our interests at heart. We're rising up, we're joining together, engaging those who represent us, and focusing on politics in some good ways through several organizations. One I already mentioned, the Secular Coalition for America. There's also the Secular Policy Institute. There's also the Freethought Equality PAC. Did you know that there's a Freethought PAC that is giving money to candidates? There are people in power on the far right who fear this future. I know they fear it. I heard them say it at the... I had memorized the name. I didn't even have to look it up. Americans for Prosperity. Anybody ever heard of them?
Yeah.
You're all members? So, 2013, the Secular Coalition for America said, "Hey, David, there's a conference in Orlando we want you to go to." And I looked and I'm like, "Oh, you want me to go there?" And I did. And I actually made it out alive. They're a fiscally conservative organization, so it was not as far right on social issues, but fiscal issues. But there is a heck of a lot of overlap. Okay. They were scared to death of the secular future that is likely going to happen, okay? They're motivated by that fear. They're not giving up, okay? That unreasonableness motivates them, all right? You know that there are things that they're afraid of in the future that involve taking God out of government, taking God out of schools, all those horrible things that are actually true already, and they don't know it, but we're trying to make sure that everyone in the movement understands that the future is bright and there are things that we can do. We need people who are scared, but not scared and giving up. We need people that are motivated, empowered, enlightened about the possibilities that this holds. So I hope that after being involved with us, with the Secular Coalition, with other organizations, that you'll feel empowered, you'll take the initiative, and you'll reach out and contact folks, and we'll help you do that. We're going to set up a system where you can do that, and we're going to recommend organizations where you can do that. So I hope you'll join us. Thanks.
Wait a minute.
They're frightened because they think that there's going to be a more progressive or even more moderate future than the past that they hold dearly. That's pretty much it in general. Now, I'm not going to go into the details. I don't have a list of all the things they were scared of, but the sense and the mood that I got was that it's very much like herding cats, right? How many times have we heard that? They're talking about the fiscal right thinks that it's like herding cats to get people to do things. Everybody uses that analogy. It's hard to get people to do anything no matter who you are. And I don't think that you have or I have the best picture when we watch our favorite news channel or our most hated news channel, whatever those might be. We don't get a clear picture of what's actually going on. But there's a lot of things they're afraid of. Our fiscal future, our social future is scary to people. Okay, I'm not afraid of that future because being afraid of it doesn't help get anything done about it. We've got to have a little bit of fear about what will happen is if we don't act, what it will look like. That's the fear that needs to motivate us. So we'll take some more questions at the end when Andrew talks. Thanks, everybody.
Okay. Are these moving?
Yep.
Okay, yes. Thank you. Obviously, today we have Andrew Bernardin speaking. Hopefully you've come to hear him talk about the four ways rationality goes awry. Andrew will outline the four all too common ways our thinking can lead us astray. Knowledge of these four ways will help us to identify weakness in our beliefs, and whether they be beliefs of others or even ourselves, who knows. Andrew researches and writes on topics from general skepticism to psychology, religion, the nature of time. He's a former professor of psychology. He has numerous articles published in the Skeptic magazine and is the author of The Naked Bible and A Turtle on the Pond of Time. So please give a warm welcome to Andrew Bernardin.
Can you hear me? Okay. Good. Great. First, I'd like to say what a pleasure it is to speak in front of a group that has come here voluntarily, rather than for the 3 credits they need for their college degree. I assure you, there's going to be no test afterwards, so that's good. You won't go home with homework, but if you choose to do some homework when you go home, good on you. All right, so. You're very good. Yes. Okay. As you all know, I'm sure, today is Sunday. It's a very special day to millions of people across the land. It's a day to congregate with like-minded others who share values and beliefs. And it's even a time for making a prayer or two. That's right. Today is NFL bowl games day. and on the field and within fans, you will have people making prayers. You know, pray for their team to get a victory. Prayer so that they're to protect their favorite players from a season-ending knee injury or whatnot. Now, this combination of football or athletics and religiosity or Christianity reminds me of the song from a number of years back, Carrie Underwood, Jesus Take the Wheel. I think I have a better idea for a country song, and it might just go platinum. Oops. There we go. Jesus Take the Football. But on further recollection, this may not be a great idea, because Jesus just might pull that loaves and fishes stunt, and then all of a sudden everybody on the field has their own football, and that'd be crazy. Okay. Introductory joking aside, I actually am going to be. I'm going to talk just a little bit more about football to make a point. Okay, with football you have large men, strong men, fast men. Sure, that when the play starts, they're rushing towards each other. Yes, they have pads and they wear this big plastic-like hat for protection. But every once in a while, you'll have this, head-on collision. Now, from thanks to Newton, we know that a body in motion will continue in motion. So once helmets hit, that doesn't stop the skull, not immediately, and the same for the brain. The brain continues forward, and unfortunately we don't have airbags for our brains. This can result in, of course, a concussion, if it's severe enough or frequent enough, the brain damage can certainly be one of the ways that your ability to be rational can be limited. But I just mentioned that in passing. This isn't one of the ways I'm going to be discussing today. And I'll get this right in a minute. There we go. There's other ways that can limit our ability to be rational, including innate factors. things we are born with. And there are a number of studies that bear this out. This from Eureka Alert, the American Association for the Advancement of Science. This study reads, political views are reflected in brain structure. Individuals who call themselves liberal tend to have larger anterior cingulate cortexes. And I imagine in this room there's a lot of large anterior cingulate cortexes. While those who call themselves conservative have larger amygdalas. The amygdala is known sort of to be the emotional center of the brain. Based on what is known about the functions of those two brain regions, the structural differences are consistent with reports showing greater ability of liberals to cope with conflicting information and a greater ability of conservatives to recognize a threat. Saddam Hussein has bombs, I know it.
Oh, that's funny.
The researchers say. Another article. Did I go too far ahead? Is here from Science Daily, another favorite site. Personality predicts political preferences. There's a strong relationship between a voter's politics and his personality, according to new research from the University of Toronto. And for those Sherlocks out there, I want you to know that Wendy and I decided on the self-propelled Toro with the large back wheels and the Honda motor. I think it was a fully rational decision. We've got books, Predisposed, Liberals, Conservatives, and the Biology of Political Differences. So we may have innate or inborn influences on how rational we can be, and particularly maybe on certain subjects we can be more rational, on other subjects less rational. But once again, I'm not going to be focusing on these because they're not so much under our control. Another thing I think it's important to keep in mind is that we have imperfect brains. They aren't computers. They come with, you might say, to use a metaphor, they come with preloaded software. It's not Windows 10, it's probably Homo erectus 1.1 that we're working with. And one evidence of this is what we call optical illusions, where our brains come primed, if you will, to process visual information in a certain way. And through optical illusions, we can see that, well, our brains don't get it right all the time. Here's one. There's a triangle, right? Actually, there isn't. There are circles with pieces missing. But our brain will fill in the gaps, and we perceive a triangle there. And I don't know if it's possible. I've tried to see no triangle there, but I always see the triangle. Another one is this. It looks like a crazy checkerboard, but when you look at it straight on, it looks like wavy lines. I assume you're seeing wavy lines?
Yeah.
Yes, they aren't wavy.
I even brought props. These are all, actually, if you measure, they're all straight lines that way, this way.
Straight sometimes. So we can see things imperfectly. You've heard the expression, when I see it, I believe it. Well, there are even constraints or limitations to our ability to perceive visual stimuli accurately. Oh, there we go. Okay. This is another of my favorite optical illusions, I guess you'd call it. If you're not fond of horror movies, you may want to cover your eyes. Okay. Here we have the upside down image of a man. Nothing unusual about that. Tilt it a little bit and it starts looking a little bit odd. Tilt it all the way around. And that is what you were looking at. But upside down, our brain makes sense of it according to, you know, its innate abilities. But those abilities can be a liability to perceiving the truth. So.
It was Photoshop, right?
No.
There we go.
I can see that now. Of course, a big, the big head honcho, you know, in psychology, at least previously, but historically, is Sigmund Freud. A lot of his ideas I reject or have been proven kind of off the mark, like the conflict between the id, the ego, and the superego, penis envy, vagina envy. But I don't think he had that one, actually. It was just penis envy. But, however, he did introduce a really nice illustration of sort of what goes on in the human brain. We have conscious experience, and we're immediately aware of it. We can be. And then what he called the preconscious, or these might be accessible memories that can become conscious. And then, and really, the iceberg that I saw originally, the subconscious was huge. And this, the subconscious, or the unconscious, all sorts of stuff happens, but it's outside of our awareness. A number of years ago, there was a study on subjects with electrodes, you know, measuring their brain activity, and they found a full second before a person came to a conscious decision, their brain activity was at its highest. So stuff was going on here, and then, boop, a second later, oh, I have the answer. So we've got this subconscious mind, and it's certainly very difficult to know what may be influencing our decision making. Okay, a few other pernicious influences on rationality. Of course, money. When money's at stake, treasure bends the lines of thought, I say. Love and hate. If you love something, hate something, boy, it's difficult to see things clearly and to not take shortcuts in our rationality. Conformity acceptance. This is a big one, too. When you're among a group where your beliefs or your rationality is going to disrupt things, you risk acceptance and or you no longer conform to the group, and we're social animals, and that's important to us. This is probably a reason why a lot of people don't come out of the closet as atheists to their family, yet they feel free with their friends. Okay, so now we get to the four ways rationality goes awry, except as this prelude kind of pointed out, it's really four ways rationality goes awry. These are sort of a heuristic that I use to help me evaluate my own thinking and to look at the thinking of others and see where things might not be as conducive to rationality as possible. And these are outline, please. By the way, I will put this up on my website later on today. Four ways rationality goes awry. The introduction, the importance of rationality to the free thought movement. What is rationality? Four ways rationality goes awry. Too little information, poor quality information, sloppy word use, or you might say imprecise use of words, and argumentation that, we'll call it goes off the rails, and maybe logical errors might be another way to talk about that. And three, the potential conflict between rationality and what I call the social graces. As well, if any of you have seen the Big Bang Theory and know Sheldon, the super rational person, he's not very good socially. He's always getting in trouble because his rational mind is in control. But we'll see that there are a number of purposes to communication. And then finally, briefly go over how context can matter. Okay, the importance of rationality to the Freethought movement. Freethought, this is a definition I found and like. Freethought is a philosophical viewpoint which holds that positions regarding truth should be formed on the basis of logic, reason, and empiricism. Those three things. And I like those that those three things are included rather than authority, tradition, or other dogmas. I'll be talking about each of those three in a moment. But Freethought, what an awesome idea. Excellent idea. However, thought isn't free or can't be free when a person isn't informed, if he or she is ignorant of alternative ideas and beliefs. Education is important. It's like if you go to a supermarket and for toilet paper and your choices are Charmin or Charmin, well, how free are you to choose? Same with ideas and beliefs. We need to be educated that there are alternatives, that there are different beliefs out there. Thought isn't free when under the influence of personal and peer prejudice. Definitely influence. The famous psychological experiment where they had, I think, five people in on the experiment, and they were shown pictures of lines, and which line is longer. And the five people who were in on the experiment would pick the one that was obviously shorter. And the one person who was the experiment was on, very frequently, and you can see them fidget, say, yeah, I guess that one is the shorter. So we are influenced by our peers and what they say and think. Okay, the problem of reason alone. I have a bit of a beef with reason, you know, being the answer to religion or a disagreement, etc. And it is this. Well, the definition says reason, a cause, explanation, or justification for an event, for action or event. Many of you may have had discussions with theists or believers, and you may present reasons, and you know what? They come right back at you with reasons of their own. And indeed, there are books, God and Reason, An Invitation to Philosophical Theology.
Right,
there we go. All right, the God of faith and reason. Faith, reason, and the existence of God. And 50 reasons why Jesus came to die. I think one of those is probably suicidal tendencies. The problem of logic alone. Well, you can think of Sheldon. This is one of my favorite cartoons of all time. It's a mathematician on the blackboard. He said, I just proved I don't exist. Mathematics is the language of philosophy, if you will. It's, excuse me, of logic. Mathematics is the language of logic, if you will. And there's a problem with that, in that the assumption of premises. Often, if you start with an incorrect premise, you can go awry. You can logically work your way through it, but come to an incorrect answer. For example, Zeno's paradox is a good example. Zeno said, okay, to move from point A to point B, first you have to pass through the halfway point. Then from the halfway point to B, well, there's another halfway point. And then from that halfway point, to be the ad infinitum. Therefore, motion is impossible. A logical, if you start with that first, well, no, actually, it's not the first premise, but that logic is impeccable, and it's actually caused many a philosopher to stumble and scratch their head and say, well, how can that be? Another problem logic, you might say, is the statement, a creation must have a creator. This is the Paley's Watch example, that you're walking through the forest, you find a watch, and you say, well, look, I found this complicated thing, this watch. It must have been created. There was a creator for this watch. Therefore, where we see this creation all around us, there must have been a creator, therefore God. Of course, many people know there's an infinite regress. That, well, then you say, well, who created that creator, and who created that creator, and et cetera. But it is my belief that this is a false premise. A creation must have a creator. If you find a watch in the forest, that is not the product of one person. That is the product of many a people over many a years, from the first sundial, to the water clock, to the pendulum clock, to the spring-driven clock. And then the materials alone.
Exactly.
You need many people working on all of those. So Paley's watch, to me, makes a better argument for either polytheism or evolution. Enter empiricism, which involves gathering hard evidence, conducting tests of hypotheses, and performing experiments. Now, this is essential to integrate into free thought, because if you have ideas that have no basis, that are unreliable, it weakens your ability to be rational. This is a XKCD comic that's a favorite. These are highly rational people, obviously. Will you marry me? Let's find out. Oh, apparently, yes. That was a test. Okay, here's my definition of rationality. And again, this is something I find helpful when evaluating ideas or in discussion with people I may have a disagreement with. The evaluating and weighing of information and argumentation in the effort to come to a judicious decision. And Lady Justice is a great icon for that idea. She wears a blindfold, which certainly symbolizes lack of prejudice or bias. She's simply weighing two things. And I like the scale itself, because rationality, well, has ratio in its etymology. And in fact, I think what we are doing when we make decisions, we're not really logically going from A to B to C. We're putting a bunch of stuff on a scale. Let's say in this plate, we put on all the pro arguments and evidence, and over here there's the con arguments and evidence, and we sort of weigh each position. Another thing I like about this, it implies that a lot of topics, decisions, are provisional. The scales can always change, the balance can change. With new information, you can change, and science is provisional. When new information comes in, you may wind up with a different different decision. And also, in terms of black and white, something is either true or it's false or it's factual or it's not. Really, a lot of ideas are, you might say, you have degrees of confidence in a conclusion. But in terms of these scales, well, let's say this is the issue is, do vaccines cause autism? Okay. A bunch of years ago, you see the Andrew Wakefield study, and then you hear from, you go to websites where there's these stories about children coming down, showing signs of autism after getting vaccinated. So, as for whether vaccines are safe, well, there'd be a lot of information in the con. Now, since then, there have been a lot of studies, and the Wakefield study was shown to be bogus. And to the rational person who is actually looking at the evidence, you would change your thinking about the safety or the dangers of vaccines. Now, here's something that I think is going to challenge all of you. Many a people with some position, let's say you're pro something, you look up information, you find information, you listen to information, and you remember information, that is pro your position. Confirmation bias would say, well, you tend to neglect the con, you don't see it, you don't count it as meaning very much. Yet, it is not other people's job to fill the con plate. If you truly want to be rational and look at an issue rationally, it is your job to both find the best material for the pro position and the best material for the con position. A number of years ago, I gave a talk to a humanist group, and afterwards, a gentleman came up and gave me two books that were about whether Jesus or not existed, the historicity of Jesus. After reading those two books, boy, they were really compelling. I was like, well, maybe there was no Jesus. Certainly not a supernatural one, but maybe there was no Jesus. So after that, what I did was like, well, I'm going to see what the best evidence that there is for the historical Jesus. So I got on Amazon, read the reviews, bought two books about, you know, Jesus being real, and read them. And now, frankly, my position is kind of like this. Maybe when I encounter further information, I'll be more confident that, oh yeah, there was probably a historical Jesus, or no, it seems like that was made up. Well, champion of rationality understands that it is his or her job to attempt to fill both plates with the best information available. Oh, that is so hard. When you're going against a con that just, oh, bothers you. Con job, yes. You know, it's difficult to do, but if you really want to arrive at the best, most rational conclusion, that's what you have to do. Four ways rationality goes awry. Too little information, poor quality information, a sloppy word use, and argumentation that goes off the rails. Okay, too little information. That's a problem. Well, there's not enough to, you know, register on the scale. Oops. To make an adequately informed decision, you need information. And the more, the better. Okay, here's an example. When I taught developmental psychology, I had the students read chapters in the textbook and then sort of keep journals where they responded to things that they learned. And one of the findings in the textbook that it related was that living in poverty is correlated with poor academic achievement. This is a correlation. Yeah. One student's response was this. I have a friend who is poor, and she got straight A's. Now, of course, this is anecdotal evidence, and anecdotal evidence can point out the exception to the rule as well as supporting the rule. She further said, therefore, I don't believe this theory. I almost got a concussion with the facepalm I did. Yes. Okay, another example of too little information. Okay. I guess I've got to be kind of discreet. I won't name names, but I come from a large family, and I have one brother who is perhaps the poster child of irrationality or poor rational thinking. So, but I have four brothers and one half-brother, so I won't name names. Okay. He believes that food is the cause and cure of all illness. Yeah. Not only that, he read a book, he told me once, Mental Illness. You're not eating the right diet if you're depressed. And finally, which was an extra special treat, I heard. Not only that, but did I know, he said, that diet will influence your sexual preference. Homosexuality is under control of what you eat. But he read it in a book. I thought about this for a moment. recently while I put this out there, and I said, hey, I think I recall something. Something that may support this position, actually. It's from the Bible. Leviticus 11:7, no pork. It says it right there. Leviticus 11:7, no shellfish. Leviticus 18:22, 23, no homosexuality. So I think God was onto something. He was saying, stay away from these foods, or I'm going to have to stone you. Okay, changing your diet can cure illness. And this pro, con, certainly if you have scurvy, changing your diet to include more oranges, yeah, that's going to work. Preventing spina bifida with plenty of greens and folic acid, yes, that's going to work. But as a general statement, well, that side, the pro has limited isolated cases and compelling reasoning. The con, well, scientific knowledge of the incredible complexity of human physiology and research that has generated weak or null findings on whether diet is an effective cure-all. Even vitamins lately have gotten a lot of studies, and there are so many vitamins, you know, the vitamin of the hour or the week or the whatever, turn out to not have the strong influence as expected. Okay, now we get to poor quality information. Meaning information that is unreliable. And because it is unreliable, because you can't verify it, because it is subjective, it should be rejected. Something that's unreliable is compelling reasoning alone. It can be paper thin, supported by nothing substantial. And here is another of that brother's beauties. About 10 years ago, he told me that he discovered this wonderful thing to increase fuel economy and power. Magnets you put on your fuel line decrease fuel consumption by more than 20%. And he said since he had put these magnets on his fuel line, he had seen better gas mileage, and I can spell placebo, or a self-fulfilling prophecy. How do these supposedly work? The magnetic field aligns the fuel molecules so they burn more efficiently. This is paper-thin reasoning. It's scientifically implausible and has failed. Most importantly, it has failed control tests. Scientifically implausible because fuel molecules do not respond to a magnetic field. They don't have a valence. So that alone doesn't work. But even if they align the fuel molecules, once they hit the injector and the hydrodynamic forces came into place, any alignment would be lost. But most importantly, control tests, magnets do not increase your fuel efficiency. So what is this? It's pure pseudoscience. Okay, another claim. Microwaved water kills plants. Same brother.
When it's hot. When it's really hot, Andrew.
He comes up to me one day and he said, have you heard the news? Yes. Research has shown that microwaved water kills plants. And I said, research has shown? So I went to my computer, and he said he was basing his claim on information, research. This was the research, a high school science project. And this is what they do. A number of pictures, I actually looked at the original research. And you'll notice what struck me was the purified water plant. It always appears to be the same. Day three, slightly different angle. Day five, something's happening with the microwave water. Purified water, I don't know if that's changed at all. That's growing. And then a completely different angle on day seven. So, highly suspicious. Here's day nine. Microwave water, yes, it kills plants.
Andrew, is he speaking in front of a group of people too on his subject?
I wouldn't be surprised. He speaks to some other members of my family, and we live in a divided household with some, you know, pro-rationality, some more, well, I don't want to, I forget the word, but speak poorly of them.
Disparage,
thank you, disparage them. Okay. So Snopes said, okay, let's test this. So they use water boiled on a stovetop, let it cool, water boiled in a microwave, let it cool, unboiled water. And not only that, they did it with three sets of plants, and the results, as we see, pretty identical, almost identical. And others too, not just Snopes, but others too, have attempted to replicate it, and no. And certainly, right off the get-go, it fails the plausibility test, because what microwaves do is they jiggle the water molecules that heats the food. There's no leftover radiation in the food that's gonna, or radiation in the water that's going to kill a plant. But my brother has some ideas about water that you'll later come to hear about.
How about holy
water? All right, here's a tip. Never put full faith in a single study, a single bit of evidence. And I see this a lot, where people say, you know, we'll make some claim and said they did a study and this is what they found. Mm-hmm. Well, here's the problem. This is an example. Recently, a psychologist performed a meta-study. He looked at 100 psychological findings that someone else attempted to replicate. Of those, 61 did not replicate the original finding. 19 did. Now, this doesn't exactly mean that the first research was bogus. It could mean the second study was off the mark or did something a little differently. Now, why is this the case? Well, it's so difficult to account and control all variables, and personal biases can sneak in the back door. In terms of personal biases, I remember this a study. It was actually a study performed on the researchers who were in the lab. They told the researchers that, hey, we've got two groups of rats, the ones we bred to be super smart over here, and the ones are just the normal rats. And here's a maze. We want you to time these rats going through the maze. And the researchers found that indeed, the supposedly smarter rats, they were saying, were faster. So, and their expectation influenced perhaps how quickly they hit the stopwatch. You know, hitting a little quicker for, oh, this is a smart one, expecting it to be faster. Maybe hitting it a little slower for one of those dummy rats. So that's why you need things like single-blind and double-blind studies, because our biases do sneak in. More poor quality information, the folklore. Okay, now this one, I think there's going to be a substantial amount of you who actually believe this false bit of folklore. I still hear it today, even though 20 years ago the issue was put to rest. And here it is. You hear this a lot. Sugar makes kids hyperactive. It's been tested, double-blind control. Sugar itself does not make kids hyperactive. They found out instead it's pizza. No, in a controlled study, you know, they found that it had no influences on their behavior. Now, why do people believe it? It could be self-fulfilling prophecy. They just notice those times. Oh, kid had sugar, now hyperactive, and they don't notice, oh, kid had a sandwich and is now hyperactive. Or the children might hear the parents say, oh, no, don't go home, go crazy, I'm giving you this sweet. And they fulfill their parents' expectations. OK. Okay, now we get to sloppy word use, imprecise words. You know, if you add the thing to the thing, you'll get good results. Well, that means nothing. I mean, precision will help you understand what you need to do, what is being said, etc. Vague and imprecise language can provide a safe haven for bogus ideas and undeserved connotations. Some of the more vague words that are bandied about remind me of Trojan horses. You know, we don't know what's in there, what connotations are being implied. Oh, and here it is. Consider each word to be a potential Trojan horse. Before using or accepting it, you should know what's inside it. Or you may just ask for another word, a more precise word. Okay. The Eastmog pendant. It's available for sale. This is actually the company that my brother is a salesperson for. Though he doesn't sell the pendant. And this is what it says. The E-Smog pendant is for personal protection against harmful radiation that negatively interferes with humans, animals, and plants' own energy fields. And, you know, the brand was not my own. The Plocher E-Smog pendant changes these fields into compatible ones for the living organism. And what is it? He protected. Yeah, I don't know how much it is, but basically it's a pendant with either rope or leather. The pendant is made of clay. It must be special clay. But this itself, the verdict, pure gobbledygook. And a lot of times you see this. People throw about the word energy or energy fields, etc. A December magazine article actually disappointed me a few years back with this title to an article: "Physicists Launch Search for the God." Well, at least they italicized it, article. But the weird thing, throughout the whole rest of the article, not a mention of God, of religion, of anything else. The only place it appeared was in the title. And to me, well, that the word God actually makes it less precise. God particle? Higgs boson. Let's be precise. However, if they were searching for the Higgs boson, that's quite the temple. The God particle, excuse me. That's quite the temple to their God. Another case might be the simple question, do you believe in God? And this is a question I really don't like, and I wish people would sort of refrain from answering it when phrased that way.
I always say, which one?
Yeah. There you go. Which God? Yes. We assume that there's just one God, but Yahweh, Elohim, Baal, this is a very short list, by the way, Allah, Shiva, Wahanguru, which is Sikh, Rowena, Iroquois, and I'm not even going to attempt to say the Cherokee name of, these are all, by the way, creator gods. Now, an apologist might say, but aren't these all different names for the same God? What this reminds me of is, let's say you've got a used car salesman and he goes about putting a Mercedes-Benz ornament on all of the cars and saying, I'm a Mercedes-Benz lot. Behind the word, besides different original names often, these gods have different people that they spoke to or speak to, or maybe even choose as favorites. They have different plans and priorities, etc. The catch-all term God, I believe, is merely used to create a superficial kinship. You know, we can get along better when we just use this vague term. But in doing so, it may, I'm not sure, I don't know, but it may make a community more peaceful if, you know, they're using the same word for basically different things. Okay, when argumentation goes off the rails, first example, I wonder if anyone is going to know what this comes from. Beautiful frozen waterfall equals God is God and Christ is his son. Anyone familiar with that?
Francis Collins,
yes. Previously an atheist, He had an epiphany when he was looking at a beautiful frozen waterfall, and that's when he realized God is God and Christ is his son. This is what is known, this is known to me as a non sequitur. I don't see how they follow. Argument off the rails number two, argument by analogy. Enter my brother. He said to me one day, again in confidentiality, he said, you know how CD discs have all this information on it, but you can't see it? Guess what's like that? Water. Water has memory. It has information in it. Of course, you know, this is the homeopathy thing. You can put a little bit of molecule in it and dilute it a million times, but that water remembers. Better than elephants. Never forgets. You've probably heard people say about homeopathy and homeopathic treatments, what's the harm? There is indeed a website called What's the Harm? And they point out, well, homeopathic remedies harm your wallet in the least, and they could harm you if you're, instead of undergoing conventional treatment that may be effective, you're putting off effective treatment. If you have cancer and you first try, you know, homeopathy, you're just putting off radiation or chemotherapy or whatnot. So there is a harm. But I'm here to tell you that my brother who sells homeopathic remedies is not harming people. I know that for a fact. Because he sells his homeopathic remedies for livestock. There are a lot of farms, and a pig, where he lives in Quebec, pig farms, dairy farms, and so he sells his homeopathic remedies for, let's say, one is supposedly makes you need to use less antibiotics, another for treating the slurry on a pig farm, you know, that's a big pool of pig poop. And the farmers buy it, you know. They may say, hey, I put something in the slurry and it doesn't smell nearly as bad today than yesterday. Argument off the rails number three. Oh, this I like. This is a caption to a New Yorker cartoon. There are two types of people in this world. Those who believe there are two types of people, and those who don't. And this is known as a false dichotomy. And we'll hear this often, you know, between scientists or rationalists and believers, where they try to present it as either science has a sterling, watertight answer, or God. There's more, it's not just these two options. It's a false dichotomy. The science may be working on it, it may be unknowable, it could be the work of aliens. It's not just science has the answer or God. Okay, and now we arrive at the potential conflict between rationality and what we call the social graces. Okay, first point to make, communication occurs on a number of levels. One of those levels is conscious commands and the sharing of information. When we talk to each other, we can be doing that. Another level is the emotional and social signals we may or may not be aware of that we're sending and receiving. In my Psychology 101 class, I would do an activity to illustrate this. And in groups, students would take turns saying, please pass the butter. But that's not all. They would do that while expressing different emotion, desires, and intentions, illustrating that your tone of voice, your pitch, your facial expression, etc., they're all communicating something. So please pass the butter might mean one thing, and please pass the butter, you know, means something differently. So there's different levels of communication. And the what you might say is the second level is the social emotional level, and to which, like the character on The Big Bang Theory, Sheldon, sort of is neglectful about. Chimpanzees are closest genetic kin, spend a lot of time grooming each other, despite the fact that most of the time they're not getting nits or flakes of skin. While they groom each other, they make these lip-smacking noises. Anthropologists have speculated that small talk and chit-chat could be considered grooming at a distance. Well, what does grooming accomplish? It helps you achieve and sustain, maintain relationships. You know, you make each other feel better. Small talk and chit-chat is similar. When you say, have a nice day to someone, or, you know, ask about their child in college, when you gossip, hey, did you hear that the Martins have declared bankruptcy? Or, you know, mere compliments. These are sort of the social glue when we exchange pleasantries that we use. When I first became, let's say, a new atheist instead of the old ones, new and improved atheist, things like people saying, God bless you, when a person sneezed, I was like, oh, how do I deal with this? I don't believe in God. And it also didn't make sense that you're blessing someone for spreading germs. To me, it made as much sense as saying, may the Lord be with you after ripping a fart. But now I've changed. I see that the vast majority of the times, this is just God bless you is gum flapping. You know, it just means, you know, there's the social emotional, the social element, like, oh, I hope you're okay. Or, hey, I'm a nice person, I care about you. So God bless you doesn't bother me anymore. There are also places and times, here we get to context, that rationality isn't called for. The boudoir, for example. Now, if my rational mind was engaged and I walked and saw this scene, my first thought might be, crikey, that's a fire hazard. But then hopefully there are electric candles and I'm able to put my rational side and focus on the social and emotional side. Okay, skeptics, highly rational people, are often considered party poopers. And this is, I'm sure a lot of you run into this. It's like you want to be true to your own beliefs, your own thinking, but in a social context, well, we're so focused and interested in the informational level of conversation, we may neglect the social emotional levels. Yeah. When people are just chit-chatting, small-talking, sometimes it can be a disruption to all of a sudden go to the rational level and disagree. Now, I'm not saying that's always the case. There are plenty of times, plenty of contexts where it's fully appropriate to be rational. Okay, a final example of how context matters. I'm sparing my brother on this one, even though he does have that attitude as well, that alternative medicine is a valid option, and in fact superior to Western medicine. I have a sister who holds this view. And last year at a family gathering, we're all in the kitchen preparing the meal, and she often, you know, drops in nuggets of her belief. So I think one of my brothers asked me how my back was doing. And she says, "Have you tried acupuncture yet?" My response was, "How thick do you want these carrots sliced?" That was not the time to throw a grenade. Discord before dinner is not good for digestion. fortunately, the next day, I was able to sit down and talk to her. She gave me some more advice about something, and then we got into it. We talked, I attempted to talk rationally with her. And there was some discord. But one of the things I mentioned was that I think this this wording is a little bit bogus, you know, using it slants the playing field, if you would. Western, Western, that's like highly industrialized, polluting, that's New World, whatever. Eastern, land of the rising sun, and all these exotic religions. So it's got certain connotations. I wouldn't call it Western medicine, I would call it modern medicine. As for alternative medicine, I see that as either pseudo-medicine or pre-medicine. Because frankly, some of the treatments that are called alternative, if they're tested, may turn out to be effective. And then they can be standardized and sold at pharmacies and they become part of modern medicine. And it is the case that pharmacies now around the world are looking for supposed alternative medicine so they can see if there are compounds in them that are effective. And then what they'll do is they'll refine them, they'll put them into pill or whatever form, and the pharmacy will have it, and then it'll be modern medicine. During that time, talking with my sister, she said she was bothered by my skepticism. I was always skeptical of what she was saying. And what was the other bit? That yes, I was always disagreeing with her. I pointed out that, well, I may be skeptical of alternative medicine, you are skeptical of modern medicine. We all have our things that we are skeptical of. And then as for being a party pooper, in her eyes, when she talks about alternative medicine, I related to her that she is the one who brings up the subject and offering unsolicited advice. So we went on and on, and you know what? That relationship did get a little rocky for a while, for weeks, maybe months. I don't see her very often. And interestingly, she is the person I'm closest to in the family. She's a year and a half older. We talk the most. But bringing rationality into the social, into that social emotional dynamic, yeah, we hit some buttons, if you will, on the other, and our relationship did, for a while, suffer. But now it is in fact better. It's a lot better for me because I'm not getting unsolicited medical advice. But you can imagine why, as I said, a lot of people find it difficult to come out to family, to engage in skeptical thought. When's the proper time? A cocktail party, someone mentions Reiki or psychics or something. It can be a difficult decision to make. One thing I like to bear in mind is know your audience. A few years back, Phil Plait gave a talk called something like Don't Be a Jerk, I think. And he was talking about atheists when talking to non-believers. Don't be a jerk.
Don't be
nice.
A dick. It was Don't Be a Dick.
Oh, was that it?
Yes.
Don't be a dick? Oh, well, that's even stronger. I think what he's saying is like keep an eye on the social emotional level of your conversation. Use words and tone and whatever that's not going to ruffle up their emotions. In terms of what affects people most, nobody knows, and it may differ from person to person. Some people may be influenced by a purely academic approach to a subject. Other people might find humorous and bombastic language to be more engaging and perhaps challenging. The truth is, we speak differently to different audiences. We all do. We speak differently to our parents than we do to our friends. We speak differently to bankers than we do to the tree guy working in our yard that's missing three front teeth. We change how we talk to match the context. And I think that would be good advice in terms of bringing rationality and addressing issues with other people. Okay. Thank you for coming. There's going to be questions and answer period, but before I do that, I'd like to just tell you a little bit about my two books that are on sale in the back. The first, Turtle on the Pond of Time. This is time a mere concept, an intellectual tool that lacks existence beyond the human mind? Join the clever animals in this book as they contemplate the nature of time. So it's dialogues. I try to make it fun, interesting, with animals discussing various aspects of time. It's basically a book that's skeptical of a very common philosophy of time now, which is called the substantival theory of time. And that is that time is part of the substance of the universe, that the future exists, it's out there. If we knew how we could get there, the past still exists, and we could visit there if the technology exists. So I'm skeptical of that philosophy, and so, you know, I have lightheartedly approached the topic with chapters like Jack and Jill's Metaphysical Hill. This is fleas that inhabit two different dogs that meet on the hill. And it addresses the questionable reality of time. Third chapter, SETI the Groundhog, the speed of time, and indirectly time travel. And another chapter, to give you an idea. Two Crabs on Infinity Beach, When the Math Hits the Fan, and Hippo's Critical Oath, Does Father Time Exist? So this is kind of a lighthearted book about the nature of time. And then, I'm out of practice. The Naked Bible, an irreverent exposure of Bible verses, versions, and meanings that preachers dishonestly ignore. Now, a number of years ago, I read through not one Bible, but two Bibles, two different versions of the Bibles. And one of the things I noticed was that the Bible's message varies from book to book. Not only that, but if you compare Bible translations, many verses are worded significantly differently, and sometimes humorously. So I kind of highlighted those things that I found were kind of interesting or funny, and I couldn't help but put this book together. And in the table of contents, they're part, the sections of the book are the 7 days of undress. Day one, biblical voodoo, the spiritual significance of foreskin, that's chapter two. On day two, the supernatural silverback, chapter 10, the Lord was a polytheist. Day three, spiritual battlephilia, chapter 24 is CSI Holy Land, who killed Herod? Day four, the ultra-conservative curmudgeon. And chapter 39 is God's view of broads. Day five, a doddering obsolete grandfather. Chapter 40 is why Bibles hide the carnage. Day six, a perfectly muddled message. Chapter 63, King David on the psychiatrist's couch. Yeah, these are all brief, brief chapters, by the way. And day seven, the kinder, gentler wrath of Jesus. Chapter 65, the good news of eternal punishment. So, if you think you might enjoy that, check it out. I did sign the books if after the question and answers and talking with people, if you'd like me to, you know, personalize it, let me know. So, are there any... Oh, I forgot to mention my podcast. Okay, at my site, I've got 26 episodes up. I've currently been on hiatus, Psychology, Skepticism, and the Pesky Problem of Gods. Episodes that might be of interest to free thought groups, Good Reasons to be an Outspoken Atheist, Religion and the Enshrinement of Hierarchy, Religion as a Replaceable Reason for Being, and No Solitary Creator, which I kind of addressed today. Oh, and it can be found at andrewbernardin.com, calling Dr. Freud, or just go to andrewbernardin.com and there'll be a page that you can hit. And you can listen to all the episodes or download them.
Hey, what did that?
finally, I'll go back. There we go. Yeah, if anyone wants to take a picture of that.
Wait, just one more. Smile. All
right. Excellent. Okay. So, any questions, comments? Yes.
Yes, I would like to make one
remark
about what you said about your sister.
Hold on.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We want everybody to hear.
I'm sorry.
I'd just like to make one remark, what you said about your sister. It seems to me that when you care about somebody and you know they're in pain, you want to help them.
Yes.
And it was just a suggestion, it seems to me, on her part, rather than a reason to be angry or say unsolicited. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I left out history, you know, with that, is that we have had, you know, previous interactions where, you know, she knows me, she's read my books, but you are right. You know, oftentimes it's just they care about you and, you know, they want to help. But what do you do if their ideas, you know, radically conflict with yours? You may choose to go the harmony route, the route as social and emotional, just a pat on the back saying, I care about you. But when it's ongoing and each conversation, again and again, I get advice. I thought it was time to talk to her. Yes?
Hold on, let me get the microphone there. We got a microphone. I'll even let you hold it, Lord.
Where was it written about the difference in size, or different shape of the brain for between liberals and conservatives? I mean, I really like to look at it.
Oh, that?
Are you skeptical of his claim?
There's a far difference in size.
Yes, Jonathan Haidt wrote a book about that. In the two articles, I think if you just look up personality and, what was that, politics or personality?
Something
was
like that.
And Eureka Alert, that was what that one was mentioned in. Yeah, if you Google it, you probably should find it. Or if you email me, I'll send you a link.
Okay, earlier you said, you talked about free thought, and one of the things you said was free thought isn't free when A, B, and C. Can you repeat those, please? One of the things you mentioned is uninformed.
Yes.
Uninformed, that's one way that is not free. And coercion, I believe, was another one, when you are coerced.
Poor information was the second, I believe.
Maybe you can answer that individually after. How
about okay.
that?
Yes.
That way you can look it up, because I don't want to put you on the spot either.
Yeah.
Oh, hi. Hi, Andrew. I enjoyed your talk.
Nice to see you.
Just to comment on the diet business, studies, as you say, show that most people don't need any supplements. You're wasting your money. You don't need vitamins, most people. If you don't have any teeth and you're eating some kind of strange diet, maybe you do, but ordinary citizen does not need any kind of supplements. Second point, though, there is something that's extremely important about the diet, and that's your consumption of saturated fat and unsaturated fat and cholesterol. The more saturated fat and cholesterol you eat, the higher your LDL cholesterol is.
Yes.
To a point, not so much with cholesterol, but with saturated fat.
Yes.
Okay. This is the most common cause of disability and death is heart disease in this country. So this is massively important on a population level. There are genetic influences on this,
I
kind of get the idea that when you say diet doesn't cause everything, it causes some really significant things. Second thing is we found the same risk factors that promote atherosclerosis lost my train of thought. Sorry. The same risk factors that promote clogging of the arteries also promote Alzheimer's disease. So it's very important. So
there are
specific elements in the diet that are extremely important, the ones I mentioned.
Right.
But generally, there's a lot of nonsense about all of this.
And I think as a preventative, food is especially important. Having a good diet to prevent arteriosclerosis or maybe the development of type 2 diabetes or something like that. But as a general claim that all we need is food, good food, organic food or whatever, and we'll be healthy.
And I think the specific thing you said, Andrew, was that the claim was that a diet can cure an illness, not that bad diets don't cause illness.
Exactly.
Those are not dichotomous, but those are the opposing opinions that sometimes get heard when we hear those things. And I know Jim is an experienced physician, so he's keenly aware of those differences.
Yep.
Martin?
So on the comment of the physiological and neurological factors that influence political or social views and dealing with the confirmation bias, is trying to persuade someone to an alternate point of view a losing battle?
It depends. It depends on, you know, their personality, their level of education, and it probably depends upon your relationship. But certainly there are those individuals that you might as well talk to a closet, you know. It's case by case, I think.
Andrew, I had a point that I thought about early on in your talk, and I've been massaging this idea for a while, and I'd appreciate your feedback on it. I think my hypothesis about how bad ideas prosper is that not enough people are saying, I disagree with you.
Right.
The social lubricant is, yeah, you might be right about that. The social lubricant is not, you're going to have to show me that that's true because I don't believe you.
Yeah.
So I think that authority from parents as well as the social lubricant of agreeing with one another cause bad ideas to be believed by the second and third party.
Yes, like the sugar causes hyperactivity is a perfect example. When, you know, parents mention that in passing or something like that, I say, hold all presses, you're wrong. You know, listen to me about this.
And you don't often find people disagreeing very cordially. And even disagreeing is not a cordial thing.
Yes.
Any questions?
I don't agree with you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Andrew.